The third week of May was stormy for Wisconsin, but there was one day that stood out from the rest.
Might be fixing the cold punch here.
On Tuesday, May 16th, 2017, a tornado hit Wisconsin. This wasn't just a two-minute EF0 tornado knocking over an apple tree. This tornado tore an 83-mile path of destruction from Polk to Price counties, up to 1 mile in width at times, damaging entire forests, mobile home park, and cleaning homes off their foundation. It was the first strong EF3 or greater Wisconsin tornado in 6 years, and had the longest damage path of a Wisconsin tornado in 88 years. Wow. Mysteriously, as far as I know, none of the folks chasing this storm, including myself, were able to get a visual of the tornado itself. Also strange was my decision to leave this storm for other opportunities. Unfortunately, there is no video of the actual tornado in this episode. I will discuss my personal decisions as a storm chaser, and what we can learn from this historic event. The remorse I feel for the victims of this tornado goes without saying. Words alone can't put somebody's life back together. Some storm chasers spend their lives looking for tornadoes of this magnitude. In Wisconsin, inevitably, a tornado of that size, length, and duration will hit something. Or somebody. Only twice in my 9 years of storm chasing have I said the words, "I'm going to see something today." This was one of them. I left home around noon towards my target of Rice Lake, about a 3.5 hour drive from Oshkosh. Instead of taking the chaser preferred Highway 29 route, I took Highway 10 west through the early afternoon thunderstorm activity. I intercepted a line of cells by Marshfield with little to note except a surprising amount of rotation at the cloud base on one tiny updraft.
This here is what we're dealing with. Coolest thing I've seen all day. It's actually rotating on the right side, and so it's going away from me on the right and coming towards me on the left. This looks like a new updraft trying to form here, a new updraft base, but nothing doing.
Even in their subdued state, I knew these storms would intensify as they moved east. This was a tempting option, much closer to home, so I stopped to keep both northwest and northeast Wisconsin options open. Storms developing to the west of the Mississippi River forced my departure from Marshfield. The first severe warning storm was heading straight into my southern target area. On the meteorological aspect, surface moisture was pooling near the warm front. All the ingredients were coming together for tornadoes, and
expected hazards include ping pong ball sized hail and 60 miles per hour.
Ping pong ball sized hail north of I-94. Things started happening fast as I slowly made my way down Highway 10. The Chetek Supercell developed, well north of the first cell, around the same time the first cell began to weaken. Interesting. It was as if all the energy was suddenly redirected north towards Barron County.
Well, right now we're heading towards a tornado warning thunderstorm up near Prairie Farm, Clayton, Chetek, Wisconsin. It's a rare tornado warning.
I took Highway 53 north out of Eau Claire, shooting for Chetek. One of the few storms I've ever had to get there for. The radar appearance was top-notch.
Alright, getting pretty close now. We are just outside of Bloomer. Colfax, Wisconsin, or the road to Colfax.
This is where the challenges began. A quick look at Chetek revealed several traps, a large lake to the east, one road through the middle of the city, poor road network, poor escape routes, a long stretch of limited access highway with maybe even no off-ramps. Highway 8, regarded as the northern no-go line due to thick forests, was just a few miles to my north. As much as I wanted to, I couldn't push it. I chose to intercept west of Highway 53 for two main reasons: safety and future opportunities.
It's 4:52 p.m. I really need to haul some butt right now.
I got off at the New Auburn exit. Even though I was well south of the anticipated track, I would use the country roads to close the gap. West of the highway, the chase terrain was not ideal either. Views only on top of hills, trees. This was when I first saw the storm, and now that I had seen it, I felt more comfortable about my position and movement.
Oh look, more trees! Hooray!
Okay, here we go.
At this stage, I preferred visual assessment instead of radar. I knew that radar would only get messier with time.
Good morning. Wax 104.5.
I passed on a few nice spots in favor of heading just a little bit further north. Compromised for a highway overpass along Highway 8, which was surprisingly due west of Chetek. When I first arrived there, there was a hazy but exposed wall cloud to my northwest. Assuming eastward movement, I would be safe at my location. The mystery of why nobody could get their eyes on this tornado is explained in this video sequence. Rain curtains were frequently wrapping around the tornado. Even when the cloud base slash wall cloud was exposed, haze made it difficult to see.
Pretty strong motion on that. Left to right on the front I can see, but I'm looking for anything underneath the base there. I see just a tornado. Pretty hard and murky to see under there.
I never saw it in person, but this picture might show the tornado crossing Highway 53 2.5 miles to my north, where it would hit Prairie View Estates Mobile Home Park. 2.5 miles away, and I could not see it.
Quite the storm going on up here. I think we're pretty close to Chetek. I don't know if that's how you pronounce it, but it's a tornado warning storm north of Dallas. Right now, it's kind of hard to see what's going on. I got a billboard in my way and some trees, but way back in here, I guess somewhere in there, you might find a tornado. It's got a tornado warning on it, and the storm is capable of producing a tornado, but really hard to get a visual on it up here. Nice green core. Just keeping an eye on it and doing the best we can with the limited visibility we have. If you're in front of this storm, take necessary precautions. I've been chasing a lot of storms in Wisconsin in my life. This one looks right up there with the worst of them visually. It got the green core on it. So just take your precautions, and if worst comes to worst, at least you're prepared. So that's all I got for right now. We're going to keep up with the storms up in this area today. Thank you. I was unimpressed. There was a tornado warning with a large amount of broad rotation. I didn't know if a tornado was present. I couldn't see it anyway. I looked at velocity scans and shrugged them off. The radar beams were scanning a relatively high part of the supercell, for which I gave too much credit for. Much of what I saw going on appeared broad scale because that was all I could see. I filmed as the RFD wrapped around, with poor visibility, poor roads, not wanting to play catch up in a forest. I packed my gear and left the storm to flounder in the forests of northern Wisconsin. I was a victim of the rapid live and die storm mentality. This is how I ended up leaving an EF2 tornado. I filmed this odd structure a couple minutes before I left, and then I was gone.
All right, now I'm relocating. The first storm was okay. I didn't get enough of a chance to really sit there and do anything with it because it was totally wrapped around high precipitation and really no visual way to visually identify anything except for that it was moving. Actually, RFT was moving at a pretty good clip. So now I'm gonna go a little bit further southwest.
I navigated down from Chetek to Dallas, even caught a near vertical shelf cloud from an outflow dominant straggler.
Pretty cool looking shelf cloud there. Wow, look at that.
Then it was on to Ridgeland for a new discrete cell.
Might be fixing the core punch here. Uh-oh. I would call it in, but I have no freaking clue what size this stuff is. Quit it! Stop! Why? Look to me. Yeah, they actually look pretty small. I'm almost out. Go, baby, go! I had to see a base now.
I core punched the long way, but it wasn't so bad. I popped out barely ahead of the updraft base and was directly underneath when the tornado warning was issued for that cell.
Coming in hot.
I spent a few minutes driving east with distinct rancors of the RFD to myself.
That's not good. Yep, can hear the hail coming down the street at me.
This was a dangerous position, so I was rubbernecking in every direction. I exited south to gain a better angle.
Well, I pretty much concluded that the storm is rotating on top of me, so I should probably get out. Might have to hook slice on this one, I don't know. Radar isn't updating. So that's convenient. Visually, nothing. Visually.
And from there I played catch up, hoping for a moment to stop and look northwest. I never got that chance. Chase over.
Well, that's a nice sight to see after the crazy severe weather that happened to hit this area today. Hopefully this is a sign of good things to come. Got a little chase caravan going on here. Met up with some fellow chasers. Kelly Cranes is one of them, and we are heading south for maybe round three. We're gonna see what round three brings us.
We made a last second play on the storm moving towards Osseo, but missed the chance to get ahead. I turned back for home, opting for Highway 29 this time. The Mamata display was terrific. I was able to catch up to Tail End Charlie after dark, and let me tell you, this storm was mean. Slipping by just south of the main core, I had a great view of its large structure. That was awesome. I was able to grab a picture later in Wausau.
Well, this is an April 10th, 2011 light show on the storm here near Athens. I have to be careful because I've been watching another area southeast of me, which I would put southeast of Highway 29 that's been reaching down and going through cycles. Wall cloud lowering, it's very high base, but not impossible to get a tornado off of that, even if it is high base at this point. I've seen a lot of weird things happen around here, and this would not surprise me one bit if it did. Man, this lightning. We're just gonna graze, getting blown across the road a bit here, just gonna graze the core on this, and I don't even know if I want to get ahead of it right now, but that's sort of been my goal since I set up, so we're gonna get real nice and close to this one here.
I learned many things from the Chetek Supercell. It changed the way I chase. I will always view turning my back on the Chetek Supercell a missed opportunity, even though I was there for a short time. I believe everything happens for a reason. There were lessons I needed to learn, such as, forecasting gets you to the right area, but storm chasing gets you to the right storm. When you find the right storm, stay with it. 50 average storms will blur your perspective on the one that matters, so you need to be able to recognize when Mother Nature flips the switch. Don't fall victim for rapid live and die cycle mentality. Maybe even chase the storm until it stops rotating. Due to its duration, path length, and strength, Chetek is a legendary Wisconsin tornado, and I recognize that this storm impacted areas other than Chetek. Ask anyone who has experienced a significant weather event. They will describe it as a different type of storm. A storm on a different level. Darker and meaner. That was Chetek. For more Wisconsin storm chasing, please visit our website, wisconsinwx.com. Check out the links in the video description for more video and information on the Chetek tornado. And as always, thanks for watching.